Hi, I'm Melody with Magoosh, and today I want to share some tips that can help you prepare for and address exam questions that have to do with geometry on the GMAT. Now, we might have taken geometry class a very long time ago. I know I did. And so if those ideas haven't stayed fresh in your mind and you haven't used them, there could be a little amount of review that you need to do. I'm happy to tell you, you don't need to learn an entire year's worth of geometry class all over again, but there are some basic principles and some fundamental things that you do need to know so you can apply the right properties and formulas on the exam. So we do need to do some reviewing, some remembering. Let's talk about that. There are the most common shapes tested on the exam, and as we learn about those shapes, we want to pay attention primarily to angle measurements, relationships between angles, relationships between angles and sides of the figure. We always want to be able to find the area of a figure for a two-dimensional figure or the volume for a 3D one, and the perimeter. Now, perimeter is my favorite. It's the easiest because if all the sides of a shape are straight lines, which most of our shapes are, then we just add those sides up and we have the perimeter. So let's look at what that might look like as we dig into the details of one of the most familiar shapes that we see in the world all around us, the circle. Now, the circle is going to be a little bit different from the others because it doesn't have straight line sides. So let's look at how we can analyze the most important facts about circles for the exam. A circle is defined as the set of all points that are the same distance from the center point. So circles are usually named with their center. Very often, not always, but very often that center point will be called O just because that's a common practice. Every point on the outside has the same distance from that center, and that distance is called the radius. If we take two radii, one radius and then another, straight across, then that length is called the diameter. Here's how those are spelled, radius. Diameter. And the basic, most fundamental circle formulas that we use are based right off of that relationship, the radius and the diameter. So for a circle, the area equals pi times the radius squared. The circumference is a special word we use in circles for the distance around the outside. It's very similar to the perimeter, but technically perimeter isn't the most accurate term because there are no straight line sides here. But the distance all the way around the outside of the circle, if you walked completely around the edge, that's called the circumference. And we have two formulas for circumference that mean the same thing. One is 2 pi times the radius. The other is pi times the diameter. Notice that makes sense because 2 times the radius is the same as the diameter. We saw that in our defining diameter, and in fact, that's another formula that we could remember and be ready to use on the exam. There are some other pieces of circles that can be tested. For example, if we take 2 radii, we cut a piece of that circle that's a wedge, almost like a slice cut out of a pizza. On the inside of that piece, there's an angle right there. That's called a central angle of the circle. The total number of degrees in a circle is 360 degrees. So that angle is going to be a portion of those 360 degrees. For example, let's say that our angle here is 60 degrees. That means that that slice or that wedge, which is called a sector, represents 60 degrees out of 360 total degrees, or exactly 1/6 of the circle, in our case, since we have a 60 degree angle. That gives us a couple of extra pieces of information. For example, let's say we wanted to travel along the circumference of this circle from one end of that sector to the other. This is a piece called the arc of the circle, an arc, and it has a measurement called arc length. The arc length is equal to the total circumference of the circle times the degree measurement of that central angle divided by our total 360 degrees. In this case, if we knew the circumference of the circle, we'd multiply it by 1/6 and we'd have the arc length. We could also be asked to find the area inside that sector. So the area of a sector, sometimes we use the phrase sector area, is equal to the total area of the circle times, again, the central angle over 360 degrees. In this case, we have a 60 degree central angle, so we could take the total area of that circle, multiply it by 1/6, and we would find the area of the sector. Okay, so notice we didn't learn every detail in the world about circles, but we have a good overview of all of the primary properties about them, and that's the same way you want to approach your review of other shapes as well. Personally, for other shapes, I think it's easy to organize them by the number of sides in the shape, and we're going to talk about straight line sides and two-dimensional shapes. For example, one line, one side, is just a straight line, and there actually are some properties regarding angles when you see a straight line. Two lines, when they cross, make an angle as well. And so you want to pay attention to when two lines intersect each other, what kind of angle properties and relationships there are. Three lines together makes a triangle, and that's one of the most important shapes you can study for the exam. Standardized tests love triangles because there are some special properties to them. Especially, you want to pay attention to what's called special right triangles. So a right triangle is one that has a right angle, a 90 degree angle, somewhere in that triangle. And there are some properties of certain types of right triangles that are often tested on the GMAT. So you want to pay attention to 30, 60, 90 degree right triangles, 45, 45, 90 degree right triangles, and then anything that satisfies the Pythagorean theorem in a special way is likely to show up on the exam. Pythagorean theorem has a relationship between the three sides of a triangle. Remember, a squared plus b squared equals c squared, and for right triangles only. Now, if those three, A, B, and C, all happen to be whole numbers, integers, that's something pretty rare and pretty special. And so when that happens, it's called a Pythagorean triple. For example, 3, 4, 5 is the most common Pythagorean triple that you'll see on the exam. So look out for those on the test as well. When we have four sides connected, that makes a quadrilateral. The common ones we use in everyday language might be a rectangle or a square. We also want to learn about parallelograms, trapezoids, different relationships between the angles, the sides in those shapes. Once we go past four sides, we could keep adding a number of sides forever, but there aren't so many special properties that will be tested on the exam. But for five or more sides, you do want to know what the word regular means when it refers to a shape or a polygon, when one is regular or not regular, and you want to be able to find information about the angles inside that shape. So that's your checklist of things to learn and review. Once you've done that, it's time to actually work on test questions. So as you're practicing test questions and building up a strategy for test day, here are some tips that I recommend. First, you always want to work from an image on your scratch paper. So it's possible when you see a geometry question, there's a figure on the screen. If so, copy it down. Sometimes the geometry is just being described in words though. So you want to make the best sketch that you can of what you're reading about. It does not have to be perfect. Circles do not have to be perfectly round. Lines do not have to be perfectly straight, but it should reasonably reflect what's going on. Remember, it's your scratch paper. Nobody's going to check it. Nobody's going to grade you on it, but it should help you work toward the correct answer. Then when you've got that drawn, you want to label all of the side lengths and angle measurements and information that you're given right onto that diagram so that you're working off of that image on your scratch paper. Geometry is a very visual part of mathematics, so you want to let that work to your advantage. One word of warning here, you should not assume that diagrams you see on the screen are exactly the right shape and size. For example, it might look like two side lengths are the same, but one might actually be bigger than the other in real life. Or it might look like one angle is way bigger than another, but it turns out they're the same. So that's a caution. Diagrams might not always be drawn to scale, is what it's called. So it might not be exactly the right relationship. Don't rely on eyeballing or estimating, but instead rely on actual numbers that you're given to work out the problem. I also recommend writing down any formulas that you can tell you're going to need to solve the problem on your scratch paper. That can also help you have everything you need organized right there in front of you. For example, if you know you're going to need to use the formula for area of a triangle, write it down on your scratch paper, and that's one less thing to worry about. Have everything right in front of you that you can work from as a resource. Now, let's say you've got all of that, but you don't see the path to the correct answer. It might be asking for some information that you just don't see built into what's given in the question. It's best not to panic, don't freeze, don't get stuck sitting there doing nothing. Instead, look at the information you have that's given to you and say, can I figure some detail out based on this? Start figuring out the pieces of information you can, and each of those will be like a stepping stone putting you on the path toward the correct answer. Let's try to put all this into practice on an example problem together, going back to our old friend, the circle. Here we have a multiple choice geometry problem. Let's take a look. Each circle has center O. So that word each means every one. That means there's more than one. We'll look out for that. Let's look at our image. Well, do I see two different circles? Yeah, I see the one on the inside with a white area filled in, and then I see a bigger circle formed by the shaded area. So what I would do first on my scratch paper is copy this down the best I can. There is no way my circle is going to be perfect, but it's my scratch paper and nobody's going to judge me for that. So I'm just going to do my best. And I will kind of shade in this outer area. I'm not going to take time to color it in very carefully. So each circle has center O, and we see that labeled. The radius of the smaller circle is 2. Okay, so I'm going to mark that from here to here is 2. Notice I'm taking the information from the written problem, transferring it onto my drawing on my scratch paper. And the radius of the larger circle is 6. Here's where it works out well that I did not fill in that circle all the way. It makes it easier for me to mark that that is 6. Here's the question. If a point is selected at random, so I'm starting to get this feeling of probability going on over here, so look out for that. If a point is selected at random from the larger circular region, so the whole big thing, what is the probability, we were right, that the point will lie in the shaded region? Okay, so quick thought about probability. Probability equals the number of desired outcomes over the total number of possible outcomes. In this case, it's going to be the probability of landing in the shaded region divided by the probability of the large circular region. We'll call it large circle. Okay, so that's what I need to find. Let's think about that. Well, I want to find a point in that location. We're looking at areas inside of the circle, and I just gave the answer away. We're really looking at area of a circle here. So I'm going to write down also the formula, area equals pi r squared, so that I don't have to second guess. I don't have to remember. It's there ready for me to use on my scratch paper. So what are we going to do? We need to find the area of the big circle. We need to find the area of the shaded region. That might seem complicated. We don't really have an area formula for sort of a ring around a circle, but not a full circle. Here's a tip that can uncomplicate everything here. Whenever we have a shaded region as part of a geometric figure, we can say that the total area equals the shaded area plus the unshaded area. So let's work with that. My total area is the area of the whole big circle, and that big old circle has a radius of 6, remember? So that area is going to be pi times 6 squared. We don't know the area of the shaded circle yet. That's what we're going to find using our little formula here. The unshaded area is the inner circle, and we saw that the smaller circle has a radius of 2. So its area is going to be pi times 2 squared. And we do just the tiniest bit of multiplying here. 6 squared gives us 36 pi. That equals the shaded region plus 4 pi. And so that means that our shaded area equals 32 pi. This is a good time just to notice that the shaded area is way, 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 way bigger than the unshaded area. And that's not really what it looked like in the original figure, was it? So this is a good reminder for us. Don't trust what sizes look like in a figure drawn on the exam. Okay, now we're ready to find our total probability. So our probability of landing in the shaded region is going to be the area of the shaded region, 32 pi, over the total area of the bigger circle. We actually found that as an intermediate step, didn't we? The total area we found was 36 pi. So we want to simplify this fraction. The pi's cancel out. Both of these can be divided by the common factor of 4. And we're going to get the final answer. The probability is 8/9. Answer choice E. And there we have it. We've got another question correct. And we're one question closer to an excellent score on the GMAT and to reaching our goals. So in review, we will need to relearn some of the information from geometry class. It might have been a few years back, but we've got a basic central set of information that we need to learn, and then we'll be set up for success. Once we're actually working on a problem, we want to draw an accurate-ish diagram on our paper, not rely on eyeballing or estimating sizes and shapes, but rely on all the numbers given to us, as well as the formulas that help us work out details about that shape. And if we're stuck, instead of just standing there staring, doing nothing, it's best to start working out the information that you can. That'll put you on the path to right answers. And I wish you great success in your preparation and on actual exam questions based in geometry on the GMAT.